First of all, thank you for inviting me. And let me underline, even if you probably already have understood that, that I am here as a private person and not representing anything else than myself. Since I formally left politics in 1996, I have not been so active in the security policy debate. But I found some reason to participate in the discussion publicly when the debate about Sweden's relation to NATO, from my perspective, had reached a level that could be described as liturgical. So I wrote two articles in October 2014 in DN, one of them, and one in Dagens Industri, which is another paper in Sweden, in September 2016. And what I'm going to talk about is a type of a summary of these two articles, because not much have happened in that discussion in Sweden since then, unfortunately. So I will not generally comment on the development of the overall security policy situation in the Nordic region, which I of course have followed in the year back, but that will obviously be discussed and commented in later on in the program. So I will sort of stick to a part of the headline of this little speech, which is Sweden's military operation. It will just be part of it. And to refer to Elena Lepomäki, it will be about options, really. I just want to quote a small article in Svenska Dagbladet from Thursday last week, which is about the overall situation. I quote, "In recent years, Russia has carried out more and more extensive military exercises," says a report from the Swedish Defense Research Agency. According to the report, the military exercises have gone from having focused on smaller conflicts to large-scale wars. Russia is preparing to fight regional wars that may last long, for example, against China or NATO, says Johan Norberg, research leader in security policy at FOI in a press release. A very small little notice in one of the pages inside Svenska Dagbladet. And as I said, I will not comment on this, but this is obviously what it is all about. So back to the Swedish debate on NATO. Liturgical, yeah, what do I mean with that? Well, the debate have been dominated by two very outraged views. On one hand, those who demand or require a Swedish NATO membership immediately. On the other hand, those who under no circumstances even can imagine such a membership. And to handle the debate, investigations have been set up by the government with the purpose to just analyze the question, not to take any firm standpoints or give any recommendation. And when the result had been presented, the political debate turned into the same as it was before the investigations, because the question is sort of blocked or have been blocked by the for or against attitudes. The non-alignment policy has historically served its purpose well, and there is no need to change it. That has been and still is the answer to those who today ask for immediate Swedish NATO membership. However, there is a very good reason to ask, what non-alignment? And is this the right way to deal with the issue of NATO membership in Sweden? Swedish security policy has for a long time lived with the concept of non-alignment in peace, aiming at neutrality in war. But this concept have had different meanings over time. The doctrine have several hundred years old, but let me just summarize what has happened during the post-war period, and I then mean the Second World War. Tagelander wanted to have, you know, Tagelander, former Swedish Prime Minister, probably known by many of you. He wanted a Nordic defense union after the Second World War, and that was basically a step away from the type of non-alignment that we talk about and have been talking about today. It didn't happen because Norway wanted another security policy solution, membership in NATO. You can say that the Swedish non-alignment policy sort of survived thanks to this Norwegian position. The concept of neutrality was then defined so that if any nation attacked Sweden, despite the declared neutrality, Sweden was free to seek help from any other nation if the neutrality was broken. The concept of neutrality was thus the important ingredient and was expected to keep us out of war. If it didn't work, Sweden were free to seek help from anywhere. During the Cold War, the non-alignment part seemed more and more important compared with the neutrality part. If war broke out, we should be able, from Swedish point of view, to defend ourselves. A strong defense became the most important cornerstone of the credibility of our security policy. The old truth that we would ask for help if neutrality was broken was now more or less gone. Denmark and Norway joined NATO, but with the important and self-imposed restriction that no standing NATO forces from other nations, especially of course from the United States, should be deployed on the land of these nations in peacetime. We all know all this. The purpose was, of course, to reduce the pressure from the Soviet Union and the Warsaw Pact on the Nordic countries. In particular, Finland contributed to this skillfully through agreements with a neighbor in the East, declared independence, and a significant defense capacity. The Swedish strongly armed non-alignment policy, then still with the epithet aiming for neutrality at war, suited well in this pattern, in fact. All the Nordic countries contributed to reduce the tension in the Nordic region and thereby fulfilling, of course, one of the most important tasks of security policy, to contribute to war not arising. The rest of the story is well known. The fall of the wall, the dissolution of the Soviet Union, and the death of the Warsaw Pact, Russia's resurrection, and also worth noticing, NATO's changing role. In Sweden, since the fall of the wall, the concept of neutrality has been removed from the doctrine. We have entered into cooperation with NATO, and our combat forces are NATO adapted, both in terms of language and technology. We have also stated that we will support our neighboring countries, but also the other European Union countries, if they should be attacked or otherwise end up in some kind of a conflict. At the same time, we have downsized our military capacity, an ability that previously was such an important part of Swedish doctrine. In addition, Sweden has become a member of the European Union, something which in security policy terms was regarded as extremely doubtful just a few years, or even a year, before membership became a fact. So once again, the development we have behind us raises the question, what non-alignment is it that has served its purpose? In fact, the term over time has had quite a varied content. Certainly the Swedish Parliament has both been informed and made the decisions that led to these changes, but the rhetoric, the wordings, has definitely not kept up with these changes. And the nation Sweden lives with the feeling that the old time doctrine still applies, even though one is not really clear about what it actually contains. One can have views on the content of the changes. I will not elaborate on that. The interesting thing is, in this context, that they are a fact. The changes are a fact and are there. My point is that, given the changes in the world we see, it's reasonable, it's explainable, that the content of the Swedish security policy has changed. It would thus be strange if today's security policy would not be customized and adjusted to today's reality, but above all to what we believe about the future. Because whatever served our purposes yesterday, it will not help if we are not prepared to adapt to what we expect from tomorrow. And in practice, in fact, this is what has happened in Sweden, at least to some extent. In this perspective, one should see the NATO question. It's not good enough to meet the demands for a Swedish membership with the argument that the non-alignment policy has served its purpose and there is no need to change it. According to my opinion, this is the wrong way to deal with the NATO debate. It must be done with arguments derived from today's reality, not from yesterday's rhetoric. In practice, NATO membership with the same restrictions as Norway and Denmark put on themselves would not really mean a very big change today. Most of the membership responsibilities and obligations have already been taken on by Sweden. But politically and signal-wise, the membership question means very, very much, extremely much. That is why I mean that it is unwise by Sweden to now request or ask for to become a member of NATO. This alone, I would underline that. This would risk creating additional security policy tensions for Finland and Sweden and the remaining Nordic countries, according to my opinion. But in this context, I mean that cooperation with Finland cannot be overestimated. It's also in that cooperation that I mean that the NATO issue should be addressed. But then, the most eager NATO opponents must disconnect from the little romantic image of Swedish non-alignment that characterizes their view. As I said before, it's not enough to refer to the fact that non-alignment policy have served our purposes historically. After all, the ability to change and adapt to what has happened in our world has characterized Swedish security policy throughout this modern history. Everything from Anders, for the Nordic Defence Union, the now no cooperation with the United States during the Cold War, the elimination of the concept of neutrality, the European Union membership to today's unilateral commitments and bilateral agreements with different countries, among others, United States and of course Finland. The non-alignment policy as a concept has survived, but the content has changed over the years. My opinion is that with today's security policy situation, NATO membership is, as I said before, not to recommend for Sweden. But with reference to the same security policy situation and an analysis of what may possibly happen in our neighborhood, it doesn't seem to make any sense to reject the possibility forever in the future. By permanently excluding the option of a Swedish NATO membership, it's an obvious risk that the idea of stability and predictability instead ends up in a type of free ride for Russia's actions in our neighborhood. That is not a good political security policy signal, definitely not. I think the most reasonable way forward is that Sweden and Finland, each in the manner desired, clarify that NATO membership is an option. And that is, I think, what Finland, in fact, have done, at least to a larger extent than Sweden, I would say, definitely. However, it's not relevant now, but if we see further deterioration in the security policy situation, especially, of course, around the Baltic Sea and the Arctic region, the option can be triggered. Finland and Sweden should use the option as a security policy instrument with the ambition of not having to trigger it. In this way, we have announced that there is a limit, which of course should not or cannot be defined on forehand. But if at a given time, in a given stage in the future, it is considered jointly, and that is extremely important, by Sweden and Finland, that the line have been exceeded, it will thus have consequences. For instance, apply for NATO membership. Not as now, where we unfortunately, at least in Sweden, the message can be interpreted. So whatever happens, NATO membership is excluded. It's not a clever way of looking forward. Formal NATO membership is a small step in practice, but as I said, a major step in security policy. It's not an easy question to deal with, and the discussion do not benefit from blurry, if I may say, so rhetorical responses as on claims and demands for immediate membership. It would be very encouraging, is my opinion, if Sweden and Finland more officially could signal that the two countries now will meet in a serious dialogue on this NATO issue. I think that would the whole security situation in the Nordic area